When you move to another country like Ecuador, like I did, you never know who you're going to meet. You're going to meet all kinds of people from many different countries and from all walks of life. After I settled down here in Manta, and on many occasions as I was out and about traveling throughout this great city, I would see this one guy who always seemed to stand out in the crowd. Standing out in the crowd is no exaggeration. He's short, he has bright white hair, and every time I'd see him, he would be wearing his Panama hat, a Panama-style shirt, and most of the time, he's wearing shorts. One day, while eating breakfast at my favorite restaurant, I got to meet him. His name is Marvin Doc Holladay. Everybody calls him Doc. Well, everybody except his wife. Doc told me that she calls him sweetheart. Doc is 92 years old, and he walks. He doesn't even own a car. While I'm riding in a taxi, I see Doc walking. As we continued to run into each other, I finally started asking him about his life. What are you doing here, Doc? Where do you come from? How long have you been here? You ever gonna stop walking? I told him I got exhausted just watching him. The more and more we got to know each other, the more I found out about who he was and about his amazing life story, his life of music. Born in 1929, he was brought into the world of music by his mother. At the age of 5, Marvin learned tap dancing, and this was the beginning of his expressionism of music. Even today, at the age of 92, Marvin still plays his music, which is evident by his never-ending tapping beats of music at the breakfast table while waiting on his cappuccino. Marvin told me that at the age of 5, he knew that one day he'd do something great with music. In high school, he joined the music program, and his first instrument was called a flutophone. It's made of plastic. In his first year, that's all he played. After that first year, Marvin decided he wanted to play the trumpet, but Mom wanted him to play the clarinet. He became very good at playing that clarinet. In his second year of high school, he became first chair playing that clarinet. He was very good and never really needed to practice much. He just read the charts. Marvin's high school band was so good in state competitions that they were eventually banned because no other schools could win. While in high school, Marvin became friends with Armin Smith. They called him Smitty. Smitty was a drummer and an African-American. Marvin was introduced to other friends of Smitty who played all kinds of black-influenced jazz music. Marvin fell in love with the genre and yearned to learn as much of it as possible. Marvin learned the tenor saxophone that he learned from reading finger charts. He acquired most of his talents and learned music from playing with these cats, as he referred to them. He loved the style, the beat, the following from fans that came out of his music. He was hooked on jazz, and he was hooked on the way jazz was played by him and his friends. He couldn't really get much training in school, so he acquired most of his skills while playing with Smitty and the other musicians that he hung out with. Marvin discovered that most white people in those days didn't care much for the African-American style of jazz music. But the more he heard and learned to play, the more he loved it. After high school, Marvin joined the Army and became a member of the military band, playing show music. He performed in South Korea throughout his complete military career. While Marvin was in South Korea, he knew that he wanted to be a musician like the black musicians of the day. After his stint in the military, Marvin studied music education in college. While in college, all he wanted to do was be a jazz musician, and he wanted to play the kind of jazz that his African-American friends played. Marvin graduated with a PhD in music education, and that's how he acquired the nickname Doc. After college, Doc went on to play music in the big band arena. He worked in the world of jazz with familiar names such as Quincy Jones, Dan Kenton, Thad Jones, Mel Lewis, Ella Fitzgerald, and Dizzy Gillespie. Though having spent most of his life in close collaboration with some of the most influential and famed musicians, himself not the least of these, Doc hardly presented himself as a celebrity, though he has every right to claim such status. I learned from my discussions with Doc that he has a book about his life. It's titled Life on the Fence. It can be purchased from Amazon. I'll put a link to it in the description. The story of Doc Holladay is both typical of the American jazz man's life and unique unto itself. It tells of a musician dedicated beyond mere commitment, soulful as few others, and talented beyond compare. In the book, An Insider's View of the World of Jazz and a Near Mythic Account of Its Origins are integrated into the tale of an authentic American idealist's life and his struggle with art and as a white man with racism. Today, Doc and his wife, Diane, are retired in Manta, Ecuador. I see Doc almost every day when he comes into Dulce y Hermoso for his cappuccino. Doc mentors other musicians here in the area. One in particular is a local sax player named Alex that came to Doc for personal lessons. When Alex first arrived for his lessons, Doc noticed the guy's saxophone was a total wreck. He couldn't figure out how this guy can possibly play this instrument. It didn't take long for Doc to realize the potential this young man had, and as a gesture of goodwill and in the interest of promoting the promising career of this very talented musician, Doc gave him his personal saxophone that he owned for many, many years. Every time I see Alex playing that saxophone, I'm reminded of this generosity, and I'm grateful for his dedication to Alex's career. That is Doc Holladay.